Good morning, everyone. First of all, I extremely apologize to the Lord and to everyone here, but we have to move on. I think I have to close this theme for this man, walking in the spirit of love. I think Fridays and Sundays we have heard series of preaching and sermons about the same. Even in our care groups, we used to discuss this, and it's really a wonderful time for all of us to end up with this walking in the spirit of love. I think this is basic and very important, fundamental to all of us, the word love. First of all, let me remind each one. Let me borrow from Anger's Bible Dictionary the word walk as it's defined in the Bible, in the scripture. Figuratively, walk is often used in scripture for conduct in life, general demeanor, and deportment. It is our conduct, it is our manner of life, the way we live. Thus it is said that Enoch and Noah walked with God. That is, they maintain a course of action conformed to God's will and acceptable in His sight. In the Old Testament and New Testament, we find God promising to walk with His people, and His people, on the other hand, desiring the influence of the Holy Spirit that they may walk in His statutes, in His commands, in His precepts. To walk in the darkness, for example, is to be involved in unbelief and misled by error. To walk in the light is to be well informed, holy, and happy. To walk by faith may be rendered through faith we walk. Faith is the spirit through which we walk. To walk according to the flesh is to gratify the carnal desires. Our flesh, to yield to fleshly appetites, and to be obedient to the lusts of the flesh, entirely opposite of walking in the Spirit. While to walk the Spirit is to be guided and aided by the Holy Spirit, the active and animating principle of the Christian life. Basic to Christian living is the word love. The word, as the word defines it, is technically more on emotions and feelings. But in the Bible, the word love is more frequently seen and read in the aspect of actions, is active. So I can say to you that I love you, but shows you something else. So generally, most of us understood love in the sense, in the sphere of what God did for us. For example, the most common passage we quote is Romans chapter 5, verse 8. How did God show His love toward us? But God demonstrated His own love toward us while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. God showed His love toward us in a sense that He is good and kind to us. A while ago, a very wonderful and powerful testimony, even though it's very short, I heard it from Pastor Vince. See, we not only felt that we are sinners and we fall short of the glory of God, but at the same time, we are deeply indebted to the grace and mercy of God in salvation, especially. Love, per se, is an attribute of God. According to the scriptures, God has feeling, affection, although rationalistic theologians have asserted the contrary. We must derive our conceptions of God from the special revelation that He has given of Himself, found in the pages of the scriptures. And this declares His love as strongly as His existence. It is held by some to be inadequate to speak of love as a divine attribute. But the Bible clearly stated that God is love. That is the very nature and character of God. We said that often says we love because God first loved us. And that is very, very true. The only way we can fully understand agape, divine love, is how God Himself expressed it to each one of us here, sitting and standing. All of us received by God's grace and mercy the very essence and characteristic of God, which is love, emanates from this thing. The kindness and goodness of God emanates from His love. The scriptures contain no equivalent statements with respect to the other qualities of the divine nature. Love is the highest characteristic of God, the one attribute in which all others harmoniously blend, according to English Bible standard, Bible dictionary. The love of God is more than kindness or benevolence. The latter may be exercised toward irrational creatures, but love is directed toward rational, personal beings like us. The eternal love of God has never been without its object. Though God can love Himself, it's not self-centered, because He Himself is love. But we say, I love myself, that can be self-centered, arrogant in a sense. Yeah? A Christian virtue which emanates from our relationship with our, especially our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The only word in the Bible translated charity, usually if you use the King James Version, you usually see the word charity, means love. It is affection, tender, and passionate attachment, a sentiment of our nature excited by qualities in a person or thing that command our affection, a virtue of such efficacy that it is said to be the fulfilling of the law. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and you shall love your neighbor. You say love is the full meaning of the law. If we love God and we love our neighbor, if we love one another, okay, that is a great Christian virtue. Luther calls it the shortest and longest divinity. It is active. It is active. And dissatisfied, if not blessing others. Christian love is piety. The greatest boon that God can give for God is love. In it, all humanity duty is summed up. Love is the first named element in the composite, the fruit of the Spirit. That's why our team is walking in the spirit of love. If we love, everything falls in line. Love is the preeminent virtue inculcated and produced by the Spirit in each Christian. The whole law is summed up in love, not in the sense of rendering all other requirements as inconsequential. Our Bible text for today is found in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17 to 24. As you sit there, let me read it to you. If you have your Bibles with you, you can follow with your versions and translation. It says here, Paul, so this I say and affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer just as the Gentiles also walk, in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God, because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their heart, and they, having become callous, have given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness. But you did not learn Christ in this way. If indeed you have heard Him and have been taught of Him, just as truth is in Jesus, that in reference to your former manner of life, You lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of the seed, and that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and put on the new self, which in the likeness of God has been created in righteousness, holiness of the truth. Let's pray for a short while. Our Heavenly Father, once again, we rely heavily on the Spirit of truth, the Spirit who actually teaches us. Even at this moment, Lord, we treasure your word, we love your word. Keep us enlightened at this moment, and let the Spirit, the teaching Spirit ministry of the Holy Spirit, be with us at this moment. In Christ's name, amen. I find here the central idea of the text. The title of the message is Christian Big Leap to Transformation. It's a Christian big leap. You see, every time we see people or person, a person, an individual accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, we cannot just automatically see the transformation. It is actually a big leap from that moment, no, to what God or we sometimes in our self-righteousness expect others to see. It's a big leap of transformation, and it requires growth and development and a lot of things in the life of a new believer, even an old believer. I find here the central idea of the text is the Apostle Paul's strong admonition, instruction, even command to Ephesian believers to stop living like Gentiles. The Gentiles means the unbelievers walk, but instead continue to walk. How? By the renewing of minds and putting on the new self. You see, walking in the Spirit of love requires a lot of things and effort on our behalf. It does not stop there. It moves on, it grows, it perseveres, it endures. It gets a lot of pressures. And secondly, the purpose of the sermon is that we would be able to understand and remind ourselves of our former manner of life and to what God has done in us and what we are now and how we should be walking in the newness of life. From time to time, we should remind ourselves of that former life and what He has done to us and now and how we should be walking in the newness of life. The central idea of the sermon I draw from this passage is there are actually important things we need to know and be reminded. We need this knowing, reminding, remembering of the great contrast between light and darkness. What we previously we are, and how and what manner of life we should produce and exemplify to please our Heavenly Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. First point is, as disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, we should remind ourselves the emptiness of our former lives. The first thing I draw from this is the nature of the dumb. Excuse me, I use the word dumb. It means those who are doomed to hell. If you don't have Christ in your heart, then you are doomed to hell. If you are not saved, if you are not related to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are dumb. And the nature of the dumb is stated in those passages. First of all, it's vanity. It's vanity, it's futile. See, their directions is toward condemnation and hell. He mentioned here that the nature of the dumb, of the unbeliever, they are blind. They are blind in their understanding. Come to think about it. When I was an unbeliever before, I used to carry with me a Bible. Ang halaban ng mga Kristiyano nung araw, sila lang may Bible. Ako din meron. I brought along with me every day the Bible with me in my hand. But the big difference is I am in darkness and I don't understand those things in the Bible. Maybe some may quote it, some may read it, some may accept it, some may, you know. But the thing is, the nature of the unbelievers, the Gentiles, they are blind to the truth. If you happen every day in our lives, we come across with people with blindness. Simple as like this. For God so loved the world, He gave His only Son. People might think that it's not the only way. We say that salvation comes only through Jesus Christ. They say, no, there's a lot of way. So they're blind. And not only that, they're excluded from the life of God. They don't have the very life of God. Everyone seated here, if you have Christ in your heart, you have the life of God. But if you don't have Christ in your life, in your heart, then you are excluded from the life of God. You are dead, in a sense. We are dead, in a sense. And another one, the word ignorance. Ignorance. You know, you will notice that in the writings of Paul, you always notice like this. No. You always use the word, therefore, no. Because why? Because the nature of the unbelievers, the nature of the Gentiles, the nature of people without Christ and without God is ignorance of the truth. And then, if you happen to see it's like a building block, vanity, blind, excluded, ignorance, and then now it comes to hardness of heart. I know some of you have put your effort maybe to someone else, or maybe to us, a group of people, or maybe your friends or loved ones. You pull everything just for them to accept Christ as Lord and Savior. But the response will always be hardness of heart. Because this is the nature. This is the very nature of the Gentiles, of the unbelievers. It's hardness. And when it comes to hardness, the finality of everything is kalus. What does that mean? Tayo. Siguro sa atin, without exempt, no, po tayo nagsasapatos. Yung mga, ano na, no? Actually, that's a very exact word, no? Hardness and then insensitivity. You know, unbelievers in general, without exception, they are insensitive to sin. Sin for them is normal and natural. Normal and natural. Right? If everyone is doing it, I'll do it also. What's the difference? Because why? There is now that the finality of kalus, being kalus, no? Insensitive even to the things of God. Now, let's see the walk of the dumb. Now we have seen the nature of the unbelievers, the Gentiles. Now we see the walk of the dumb. We see here licentiousness, or sensuality, or immorality. We see Paul also use the word practicing. You know, the unbelievers, the Gentiles, it's a way of life for them to sin, to violate God's law, to disobey God. For them, it's pure sensuality. Look around, gay marriage. Yeah? Just a sample, I'm giving you a sample. How the unbelievers, the Gentiles who have no light, you know, violate God's command. These are just one thing I'm telling you. Even legislations create certain law that violates the very basic fundamental law of nature, and not only that, the fundamental law of God. in marriage. We see here they are practicing, no? They are practicing. They are impure in a sense, because in the absence of God in their life, maybe some of them, they said, I know God, I have religion, but the Bible clearly says, Paul says, no, they deny God by what they do. By what they do. Now, the second point I'd like to ask for us to see, you know, here, as disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, we should remember how God has transformed us into new creation. I want to thank Pastor Vince, even a very short nabit ako. Makita natin, we just heard him, yung kanyang testimony, how God has found him. In reality, we did not find God. God found us. Because we are lost. If we are lost, we are blind. The very nature of an unbeliever, a person without eyes, he's blind, he does not know where to go. There's no light, and there's no possibility for him to see the light of God, the light of the truth, until otherwise God himself intervened to our lives. There's no arrogance here. That's why you see Christians are said to be that if we boast in the Lord, because there is nothing to boast about. We cannot boast, oh, my friend, I found Christ. Oh, my friend, I found God. No, God found you. And that is grace. And that is mercy. See, the nature of genuine transformation is the first thing we can see here. I can see here the gospel presented. See, the word he used is this. But you did not learn Christ in this way. Say, when we heard the gospel, the first thing that the people will share to us, the first thing that person shared to me, I remember, is that, James, you are a sinner. Therefore, I learned Christ, that Christ is holy. And he died for us pure and holy. The only person, no, who can take our sins because of His holiness, His nature. The nature is, again, you see here, gospel. I can see here also discipleship and sanctification. This is the nature of genuine transformation. Okay? When we were presented with the gospel, we see how wretched we are. We see how sinful we are. We see how desperately we need someone in place of us to rescue us in our sins. This is the good news. The word gospel means good news. And we will represent, this is the things we learn from Christ, from the teaching of Christ. And then it goes over to discipleship. Growth. We can see here, I can see here, remember, as a disciple, there should be trust in God. Trust in His Word. There should be obedience. How are we obeying God? In our transformation, nobody has seen Christ here. But we obey Him and love Him. Isn't it wonderful? Is that an amen? Huh? That is something beautiful, because the very faith that we have comes from God. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is a gift of God. Our faith, our obedience, our faithfulness, our humility, our faithfulness, our truthfulness is a gift of God. And then our sanctification. Let me read it to you, that passage. You did not learn Christ in this way, Paul reminded the Ephesians. Indeed, you have heard him and have been taught in him, just as true is in Jesus. How did we hear him? How have we been taught of him? From the scripture. See, the very scripture that we hold in our hand, every day we read them. See, every time we read the Bible, we are continually hearing and learning about Christ. How much you spend your time from the Word of God, we will show also how you grow, will be. John 3:16 is not enough. Maybe that can be the beginning. But the end, probably, Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Remember that. The nature of genuine transformation, the presentation of the gospel, and then moves on to discipleships, and then moves higher to sanctification. Our godliness, our living for God. Now the walk of the saint. What we should be doing. Paul said, lay aside the old self, and then renewing of the mind, and put on the new self. You see, we have to do something. We walk by faith, not by sight. We have to act on our faith. So here I can see three things here. You see, we cannot just lay aside the old self. We cannot just lay aside the old man, but we need also what? Renewing of our mind. Constant, daily reading of his word, meditating, understanding, and doing it. Doing it. Acting on it. It cannot just go in here. It has to be lived out in our lives. Very important, basic. We cannot grow apart without these things. And then, at the same time, we put on the new self. You got to lay up the old man, renewing our mind, and then putting on the new self, putting on Christ. Putting on Christ. Every day, we learn something about truths, absorb it, believe it, live it. Then, that is the way we put on the new man, the new self, which is created in the image of God. Third point. As disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, we should manifest an acceptable living as children of God walking in the spirit of love. I find here three things, very important things. Manifesting righteousness, and that is outwardly. How we live, this is active in a sense. Huh? How we think, how we speak, and how we act. This is manifesting righteousness. This is supposed to be the acceptable living as children of God. We claim to be children of God. So it's very important that righteousness manifests in our lives every day, every moment of our lives. Then the next thing the word he says is holiness. It has to have to do inwardly. Inwardly. See, I cannot see your heart, I cannot read your minds, but God can do that. So there is also, you know, in us that God finds acceptable and pleasing because we think. The way we think, the way our heart process, our minds process, is acceptable to God. I always remind me of Philippians chapter 4. Whatever is right, and the rest follows. These are the things that should be in our hearts and mind. Then manifesting truth. This, I think, is holistic by entirety. I remember one passage in the scripture in the prayers of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is what he said, sanctify them by the truth, thy word is true. Sanctify means set apart from the world, set apart from the flesh, yeah? Set apart from sin. And how you will do that? The prayer of the Lord Jesus Christ says, sanctify them by the truth. Thy word is truth. You see, the word of God is the agent of transforming. You cannot find it anywhere. I, minsan nasasabihan ako, I'm ko sinishare sa Bible na, na lasat. You know, James, the problem with you, you have a narrow mind. You believe that? That you have a narrow mind? Yeah? Tuwan-tuwa ako, nung na-observe yan, sabi ko, ah, that's true! I have a narrow mind because my mind is constricted, compounded, limited by the Word of God. Kung makikita niyo sa Bible, no? Akala ko nung araw, pag open mind ka, agreeable, mas maganda. Kasi ang open mind, accept everything, no? But do you not know that Christians are narrow-minded? If you are a real Christian, you are narrow-minded. Because why? You are compounded ng Word of God. Restricted ganon, no? Tama ba? We cannot just accept everything the world offers. We are actually narrow-minded people. Because our mind is what? Immersed on the Word of God. And that is praise the Lord. Pag every time na sinabihan ako, I have a narrow mind, thank you. Praise the Lord. Because why? I cannot accept the teachings, the opinions, the principles of this world. Sabi ni Apostle John, he who loves the world and all the things in this world does not have the love of the Father. See, the world offers nothing but vanity. Vanity. If we will continue reading after verse 24, Paul connected this with series of therefore. Magaling niya si Paul. Kaya tawa ko sa kanya, the apostle, therefore. Lagi yan, pag nagbigay siya, if he, after giving doctrines, after giving biblical teachings, principles from God, then he connects it with application. And I just want you to listen from the seat. Ephesians 4:25-30. See, after saying this, all these things, nakita natin yan, sabi niya, therefore, laying aside falsehood, speak truth, each one of you, with his neighbor. For we are members of one another. Be angry, oops, and yet do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not give the devil an opportunity. He who steals must steal no longer. Lagi ko yung panahon niya, maraming magnanako doon sa Ephesian Church, no? Na sinulat ni Apostle Pablo, oh, kayo, nababalita ako, may nagnanako sa inyo. Ah, sabi ni Paul ngayon, okay, he who steals must steal no longer. You're already a Christian. No? You are God's children. You are related to God. And God is light. And God is righteous. But rather, he must labor. Yan, ha? Hindi na nga nulugan, hindi ka na magtatrabaho. Actually, magtrabaho ka na maligi. No? In our workplaces, how are we doing? Yeah? Minsan, hindi lang tayo nang hindi ng momento, eh, baka naman yung performance natin, eh. Di ba? So perform for God's glory. Performing with his own hands what is good, so that he will have something, the purpose, to share with one who has need. Ha? Kaya pala tayo nag-work, sabihin natin sa sarili. Ang purpose din pala yan ng Diyos sa atin is to share, not to keep it. Share it. Happy birthday, Pastor. Share. Ah, ano pa? Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification according to the need of the moment, so that it will give grace to those who hear. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ also has forgiven you. Application na yan, agad. Ha? Alam niyo, natapos na yung death of the Paul. Ito pa. Last. Ephesians 5:1-2. Kasi connecting yun eh. Actually, dinivide na lang mga chapter-chapter. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children. I love that. No? We imitate God because we are God's children. He loves us. That is the basic fundamental of our motivation. That's why we should live righteously. We should live godly. We should live truthfully because we are God's children. And there again is the admonition of Paul. Imitate God as I imitate Christ. Imitate me as I imitate Christ. And then, verse 2, and walk in love. Okay. If you love somebody, will you do harm on that person? Biblically, sa Roma, sabi niya. Because love do not do any wrong. Tignan niyo maigi. How we conduct our lives. How we treat each other. How we talk to each other. Is there respect? Is there kindness when we talk to each other? No, sometimes, yes, we fail. I fail, and don't tell me you don't. We fail, every one of us. But, sabi nga, we walk in love. Kaya yung meaning of love, dinefine it all, love is patient and kind. So the both enough is patient. We should be patient with one another. Okay? We should be kind to one another. And we should not treasure, we should not keep wrongdoings. Nagkalagay pa tayo ng listahan. Point 1 ka na, point 31 ka na dito sa akin. Ha? Malapit na maubos pasensya ko sa'yo. 32 points ka na. Ha? Ang blacklist ba kayo sa violation sa traffic, ilan ang black points? 10? Ilan? 24? 24 na, ha? Maraming dyan. 24 black points. Parang ang dami, no? Dapat 5 lang. Okay. So, and walk in love because just as Christ also loved you and gave himself us up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. That the name, sabi yung last example is yung Colossians 3:16, I think. Yeah. Let the word of Christ richly dwell in us. Let the word of Christ richly dwell in us. God bless us all.